What do you do, YouTube? It's your boy Dale, man. And we back in the trap. We whooping up another banger, man. Today, we ain't got no music. We got something different. We got revealing the WWE secrets in 20 minutes. For a lot of us who still not in the red, like, and you wonder, like, what? I wonder what the fuck happened as a kid. They gonna explain all this. You know? Rest in peace, my favorite wrestler, Eddie Guerrero. Chris Benoit. Yeah, I know. But that nigga, he was hard, don't lie. That nigga was an animal.
WWE uses a lot of tricks and secrets to create their iconic moments.
They're my two favorite.
Locked the Undertaker inside of a casket and set it on fire. Those flames were real, so how did the Undertaker escape and survive? Well, after being chokeslammed and having the lid shut, Undertaker escaped through a secret door. At the bottom of the casket, there's a section of padding that can be pushed out. Since the casket is right next to
the... Hey, bro, I imagine that was fucked up, man. I used to think Undertaker died every time. Oh, no lie, bro. Yes. I know it was a story, the nigga never died. But I used to think this nigga was dead, and every time he came alive, you know, Undertaker comes back alive. No, you're not. You playing with me, bro. Stop playing with me. No, he not. Yeah, Undertaker, that nigga back alive. Then the nigga died for the fourth time. I was like, man, fuck him. But once that music, that da 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 da, oh shit, legendary nigga. When the theme song of the Undertaker come off, da da, ah, you know somebody gonna die.
The ring. The Undertaker simply pushed the padding out and crawled under the ring. Kane and Paul Bearer intentionally blocked the view so that no one could see Undertaker escaping the casket.
That's more.
2 years later, The Undertaker avoided another near-death incident when Shane McMahon jumped from the top of the Hell in a Cell at WrestleMania 32. We saw how the dead man survived, but how did Shane avoid killing himself? Well, there was actually an airbag hidden underneath the announcer's table. You could see the bag deflating after McMahon hits the floor.
So this shit was... Oh, I didn't know that shit. I be thinking these niggas be falling. But I'll be thinking this is shit that be at Style Zone. Almost, it's the same shit. I used to think this shit be real. Like, oh shit, he flew through the announcement table. Damn, we ain't gonna get through 20 minutes, but I'm talking too much.
This moment still had to hurt, but at least there was some
cushion. I know it hurt.
A less painful moment was when Kurt Angle sprayed Stone Cold and an army of wrestlers with milk. You might not believe this, but the entire thing is a lie, sort of. That is not milk that Kurt Angle is spraying everyone with.
What was
Since
it?
Since the arena and all the wrestlers would smell really bad due to the milk spoiler,
yeah, that was the fun part.
Had Kurt Angle spray water. To make it look like the Olympic gold medalist was using milk, they added white coloring to the water.
Boy, what's the nigga name that own it? Shawn McMahon? Nigga, you a legend. Nigga, I still think, I didn't know that shit. I thought that was actually milk. Kurt Angle. Another great one.
Really bad due to the milk spoiling. WWE instead had Kurt Angle spray water.
That was the funny part.
Looks like the Olympic gold medalist was using milk.
They want to clean that shit up.
The water. While the milk that came out of the hose was not real, the milk Kurt Angle drank at the end was, which created a problem. The milk stained Angle's shoes, and when he flew on a plane the next day, he smelled awful. There's only ever been 5 buried alive matches in WWE history, but when they do happen, it's pretty special.
Ooh.
A wrestler wins when they bury their opponent inside a grave. No wrestler has ever actually died.
Did you see that stunner?
So the secret. The first trick is that the grave is always built on what's supposed to look
platform.
Like a hill. This is what allows the grave to be very deep. Speaking of which, while the sides of the grave look like dirt, they're actually just fabric.
Got eyes.
The grave, he'll pull back the fabric and go inside a small hidden room built into the side
of the
grave.
Get the fuck out of here.
The wrestler's opponent will usually do something dramatic to give the wrestler who's getting buried enough time to get into the hidden room.
That's why y'all don't fuck with kids' imagination. Let that bitch believe she got an imaginary friend, because we usually think this shit is real. Now I'm getting brain fucked over here.
Before the dirt fills the grave. The room is just big enough for the wrestler to stand up and move around in. This is how The Undertaker was able to have his hand rise from the ground after the first buried alive match in 1996. That's how WWE does a buried alive match, but what about when Paul Bearer was buried alive under concrete? You might be surprised, but that was mostly real concrete. However, there was some oatmeal mixed in to give it texture. How WWE pulled off the stunt was, before the show started and before fans were at the arena, WWE
thought that shit was real too. Tank
as they filmed it. Then, during
that boy
the
ugly as
WWE would play these pre-recorded clips to make it look like
that nigga so ugly, he looked fake.
Tank was getting filled. Now, during the
like he got a damn mask on already. That boy that ugly.
The actual show, there was someone in the tank. But that was a professional stunt person who was pretending to be Paul Bearer. In order to make it believable, the camera crew had to avoid showing a clear shot of the tank, since fans would have been able to tell that Paul Bearer wasn't actually in there.
Never knew that.
This one may not be a iconic moment, but it was memorable. On Raw, Triple H attacked Stone Cold Steve Austin backstage. It was actually a pretty stupid move, as Stone Cold not only got the upper hand, but he locked Triple H in a room with a rattlesnake.
Oh,
that was a real rattlesnake that Triple H was next to, but he was-
I don't like snakes, yeah. I just don't like it. They creep me out, bro. They creep me out. They give me the heebie-jeebies. Like, I ain't scared. Like, you put that bitch and throw it on me? Don't throw it on me, because I will swing on you, bro. I'm dead. I'm best friend. Nah, you throw a snake on me, I'll beat your ass. I'm going to try, at least. Don't throw no damn snake on me. Put shit around my neck.
Wasn't in any danger, taking both the game and the rattlesnake.
Frank or not.
One of the most shocking and infamous moments in WWE history is when Vince McMahon's limo blew up with him inside.
Swing
wheel,
yes.
As you might guess, WWE pulled the stunt off by pre-recording the explosion. But do you know exactly when the moment goes from live to pre-recorded footage? It happens right after the camera changes from behind Vince McMahon to a wide angle of him entering the limo. WWE did a pretty good job, but you can
they
see
did.
The live shot
on everything.
What makes for a great vacation?
WWE is shit. That's why it's still strong today.
Are you looking to get away?
It's just the younger generation. It's what it is. Like, we outgrow the shit. And some of us don't. It be like niggas 35, 40 fucking with wrestling. I feel like it's a good thing. But my favorite people left. That's why I left shit. But, like, they get a new generation. Another little 10-year-old boy, 11-year-old boy. Now Miz is a person. Back in the day it was John Cena, now it's Miz. You feel me? Now it's Logan Paul. It's a new era. Every new kid, new era.
Trailers behind the fence, and only one when the limo explodes. Also, the fence changes a bit between the two angles, and there's also a tree that wasn't there before. Now, to perform the stunt safely,
I ain't paying that shit no attention.
The limo, the camera stayed completely still. McMahon then left the vehicle, and once everyone was safe, the explosions went off.
It's still a limo.
Footage, so it looked like the explosion happened as soon as Vince shut the door. Something else worth mentioning is that for a single frame, you can see part of the device where the explosion came from. One of WWE's most disturbing moments was when Diesel saw himself inside a casket. Whoever is inside looks exactly like Diesel, so how did WWE make it look
I
so
never
real?
Seen this one.
That is actually the real Diesel or Kevin Nash inside the casket. Raw did not air live at this time, so before or after the show,
WWE
took shots of Diesel actually in the casket.
Re-recorded the shit.
The shots were tight enough so that you couldn't tell that they were filmed at a different time. Now we also see shots
of
Diesel and his body in the casket. For that, WWE had a dummy that they dressed up to look like Diesel, and since the camera was far enough away, fans couldn't tell.
Okay. So in our arena, they had the dummy. When they played it on TV, they just put him in the box, recorded it, then recorded him out the box, then put the edit the shit in. Okay.
The Undertaker is cool for a lot of reasons. One of them
legendary.
Is because of all the supernatural stuff he can do. How the Undertaker's tricks are performed have been mainly kept a secret, but thanks to some fans, the truth was revealed. For example, the Undertaker suddenly appearing in the ring after the lights go out
has
been exposed.
Nigga.
Several fan cameras have captured the Undertaker rolling in and from under the ring when the arena goes black. Other videos have not only shown the Undertaker
getting
into the ring, but production staff helping him by handing the dead man his hat. Of course, this isn't earth-shattering news, but it does make Undertaker suddenly appearing in the ring
look a little less scary
when he...
All the real shit that nigga did is just appearing in the ring, bro. No bullshit. Nigga just, oh shit, the Undertaker, don't lie. That nigga be rolling under the stage. The whole time. It must be big as hell under that stage, bro. They be having a church, the motherfucking sledgehammers, the motherfucking tables. That motherfucker gotta be at least 4 foot tall underneath that motherfucker ring. His big ass underneath that motherfucker. Shit.
You see how it's done. When wrestlers bleed in WWE, it's usually real blood. Although, that's not always true. Back in 2016, Triple H attacked Roman Reigns on Raw. The beating was so brutal that it busted open Roman Reigns' head. However, thanks to footage filmed by a fan, we can see how it actually happened. After Triple H slammed Roman's head into the announcer's table, and while the cameras were off him, Byron Saxton handed the big dog a blood capsule. Then when the game came back, Reigns had blood on his head, appearing as if he had been cut open. It's no surprise that all the ways WWE makes things seem real,
once that camera moves, camera tricks. It's over with.
Sometimes, WWE will cut to a different angle at the last second to make a move seem more impactful. However, thanks to one fan sitting in the front row, everyone was able to see one of their camera tricks firsthand. On Raw, Seth Rollins grabbed a chair and began hitting Drew McIntyre with it. Cell phone video from a fan in attendance caught the cameraman squatting down and up. Of course, this was to shake the camera, so that every time the chair connected with Drew's back, it seemed
more cool. No!
Pretty much all the fans talked about so far only managed to expose one WWE trick. This next fan, though, uncovered a ton of WWE secrets in just a few snapshots. In 2014, a fan at a WWE show discovered a script for Raw that had been left unattended and decided to take some pictures and share them online. The images show the outline for an entire episode of Monday Night Raw.
That's what wrestling is, bro. That's what I had to understand. Like, this shit is a fucking book. A movie. These niggas are actors, bro. And this shit's so good, they make it seem like it's real, bro. There's nothing wrong with it, bro. Now, I still think this shit, I'm getting brain fucked. Because I thought all this shit was real as a kid.
And included
your imagination,
who's
crazy.
The producer for a particular match, how long each match needs to be, the exact lines
by Van Damme
to say, it is futile to resist, and more. Hopefully no one found out which WWE employee left the script unattended, because Vince McMahon probably would have something he would have liked to say.
Yeah, yeah, getting trouble, fire.
No pervert.
Wait, that's not right.
You're fired!
That's more like it.
They're fired.
With how many matches and segments are on a WWE show, the ring has to be adjusted throughout the event. The ring crew usually needs to be pretty quick too, since the
The only way to do it is to automate it. Mm. What Zapier allows us
how
to
much
do
you think
is
they make
to our
setting that stage
customers,
up.
Shopify store.
Let me set up a wrestling stage.
The majority of WWE shows are on live TV. The actual changing of the ring apron and canvas is usually something WWE doesn't show, but thanks to fan cameras, it's possible to see how they do it. While this isn't really
God
a secret,
damn cell phones.
Sometimes the ring crew cut things pretty tight. For example, at the 2017 Payback pay-per-view, the production staff were changing the ring for the Cruiserweight match. They might have been short on time or not going as fast, because Neville was making his way to the ring while the crew were still getting it set up. Luckily, the WWE employees got out just before the champion got in the ropes. If you watch this on TV though, you probably had no idea how close WWE was cutting it. Signs are an iconic part of wrestling. It's a way for anyone to show their support for a wrestler, or just speak their mind. A majority of signs that you see in the crowd are real, and are created by actual fans.
Okay.
However, WWE will make their own signs, and put them in
the I feel like the toxic ones are the ones they make.
...audience to help push their agenda. During an episode of Raw in 2018, fans shared that WWE employees were handing out signs that said, "We want women's tag championships." Just a couple of months later, WWE would announce the creation of tag team titles for the women's division. Have you ever wondered why some wrestlers' legs look weird? Well, that's because mainly female wrestlers wear sheer tights under their ring gear.
Okay.
These tights are thick enough that you can't see through them, and there's a few reasons why wrestlers wear them. One reason is to protect a wrestler's legs from getting mat burns.
Okay.
Similarly, the tights hide bruises and other imperfections so that wrestlers look their best when they perform in front of fans.
Okay,
the sheer tights
facts.
Also prevent wardrobe malfunctions in case a wrestler's attire gets...
That's what I thought it was.
Wrestlers pick a pair of tights that match their skin tone, and with the right lighting, it's hard to tell that they're wearing an extra piece of fabric under their attire. The microphone is...
Nigga, and that's facts, bro, because I thought that shit used to be a real damn... I didn't know that shit. You learn something new every day. I kind of knew some of it's like dudes when they go hoop, they wear the compression pants. Compression shorts, I mean.
It's an iconic part of WWE, but often overlooked. It's also fake! Sort of. While the microphones used in the arena are real, the ones you see backstage are not. Instead, the audio during a backstage interview is picked up by a boom mic that's not seen on camera. The microphone that the interviewer is holding is just a prop. The reason WWE does this is so that the audio gets picked up clearly, even when there are multiple wrestlers being interviewed.
Okay.
And if the interviewer needs to walk away, viewers at home can still hear.
John Cena, because you can't see him. Get him.
Well, there's cameras in here. It'd be kind of weird if there were cameras in the locker room if we didn't have an interview.
All right, okay. All right. Actually,
I'm getting pretty good at this whole interview show thing. I think they're going to give me my own show on the WWE Network.
One way to look like a cocky son of a gun is to chew gum as you walk to the ring.
They ain't chewing gum.
There's actually practical reasons why wrestlers do this. One is that chewing gum keeps saliva flowing in your mouth.
Okay.
This helps prevent wrestlers' mouths from getting dry so they can talk clearly with each other and plan out moves during the match.
Oh.
Additionally, wrestlers can also spit out the gum after getting hit by a big move to make it seem like a tooth or spit got knocked out of their mouth, which makes...
Swear to God! I thought it was just to calm the nerves in this down, or the nigga just had stanky breath. Saliva, so they communicate, because you know they wrestling and shit, getting tired, nigga might need some water. He got cotton mouth, so the gum is preserving that. Then if he get kicked real hard for dramatic effect, he make that gum look like a tooth fly in his mouth. Boy, they some geniuses.
Makes the match seem even more brutal. Another thing wrestlers like to do before walking out is wet their hair. In addition to making wrestlers look cool, there are other reasons why WWE stars do this. Since wet hair is heavier than dry hair, it'll move and get whipped around when wrestlers get hit. This makes the moves look more impactful, which makes the match more enjoyable for fans. Another reason wrestlers wet their hair is to literally stay cool. In addition to how physically demanding wrestling is, wrestlers also perform under bright, warm spotlights. To help keep them from overheating, wrestlers will wet their hair before coming out, or in triple...
Bro, that shit's so cold, so when they was getting hit doing the rock bottoms and their hair was just flying everywhere, it's because it was wet. Boy, I don't think I'm supposed to watch this because I'm going to lose interest now.
Bellacious case as you're walking towards the ring. Sometimes wrestlers do this.
I used to wonder why he did that.
Goldberg would pour water on his head before going out, so the pyre he walked through didn't stain as much.
Okay.
Jeff Hardy also made sure he was wet before getting blasted in the face by Pyro in 2009. After you see this, you'll never look at Randy Orton's power slam the same way again. Watch these two clips and see if you notice anything different.
Everybody jump at the same time.
Playing the United States Championship on Sunday.
Damn.
Of course, in the first clip, Randy Orton successfully performed the power slam and was unsuccessful in the second. But take a look at Orton.
Numbers move you, but some...
Let me guess. The dude, he actually jumping, and when he jump, he grab him.
...can stop you in your tracks, like the tens of thousands of people who were diagnosed with certain HPV-related cancers.
I'm actually learning some HPV shit, though. I ain't even gonna lie. This is a good-ass video. I'm learning some shit.
When he hits the power slam, he claps his hands right before performing the move. Notice how, in the second clip, there is no clap. This isn't an isolated incident. Take a look at these clips. If Randy Orton is going to give his opponent a power slam, he'll clap his hands. If he isn't, then no clap. This tells the Viper's opponent whether they need to take the move or not. This isn't the only hand signal that wrestlers use.
Hey, what the hell I want to jump in the air and land on my back for?
Know if they'll take the move or counter it. The wrestler executing the DDT tells their opponent what to do with a slap on the back. Like the power slam, a slap...
Never! That's what the... Me? Oh, nigga, get back up and flip me too. It's my turn to flip. Fuck no, bro. This shit is good. Hey, shout out my nigga Tap Out Corner. My nigga got 528,000 subscribers. You deserve it, man. You deserve it more. This video is legendary, bro. This video is legendary.
Notice how in the second clip, there is no clap. This isn't an isolated incident. Take a look at these clips.
Basically, they throwing sign language out.
Power slam, he'll clap his hands. If he isn't, then no clap. This tells the Viper's opponent whether they need to take the move or not. This isn't the only hand signal that wrestlers use.
Have you clapped
when a wrestler
back.
Performs a DDT, their opponent needs to know if they'll take the move or counter it. The wrestler executing the DDT tells their opponent what to do with a slap on the back. Like the power slam, a slap on the back tells the wrestler to take the DDT.
Oh, he just hit the back.
Then the opponent needs to counter.
They're really
an
doing that
this
shit.
Happened during Alexa Bliss and Charlotte Flair's match at Extreme Rules 2021. The first time Bliss went to perform a DDT, there was no slap and Flair countered. However, the second time Alexa went to perform the move, she slapped Charlotte's back and the DDT.
So it's okay.
WWE wrestlers use many other.
Okay, if I don't smack you, you get the flippy. If I do smack you, I get the flippy. Ooh.
Hand signals during matches. When Chris Jericho and Triple H were having a match, the game sneakily communicated he wanted to give Jericho the boot by tapping his quad as Y2J was running toward him. On an episode of Raw in 2014, Dean Ambrose and John Cena were wrestling in the main event. Raw was about to go off the air, so Dean Ambrose made a signal to Cena to speed things up, since they only had 6 minutes left.
I thought he was bringing it on!
Right before Shawn Michaels hit Vince McMahon with an elbow drop from a ladder, the referee squeezed McMahon's leg to tell the boss to brace for impact. Years later, at WrestleMania 29, CM Punk was accompanied by Paul Heyman for his match against The Undertaker. During the fight,
hey,
the Deadman grabbed Heyman by the...
How do you prepare for somebody finna jump on you from fucking, I don't know how, up in the air? Like, you gotta prepare for a nigga to fall on you. Hey, nigga, how did I prepare for that shit? Like... like a nigga at the gym to get done lifting weights. How you prepare for this shit? Damn. Nah, I tell that nigga I ain't ready yet. Tell that nigga about an hour. Hey, I salute wrestlers, because they gotta go through so much shit.
Late for having a match, the game sneakily communicated he wanted to give Jared...
Okay, here we go.
...by Paul Heyman for his match against The Undertaker. During the fight,
oh,
the Deadman grabbed
fuck.
Heyman by the throat. Punk then attacked Taker with a clothesline to break it up. Since Undertaker had his back turned and couldn't see CM Punk, Paul Heyman squeezed Taker's shoulder so he knew to turn around and take the clothesline. A common spot in tag team matches is where the legal wrestler is crawling on the mat and is trying to reach their partner to tag out. However, the legal wrestler
I used to hate
that where their opponents are and won't know when precisely to tag out.
I used to hate that shit. I'd be like, hurry your ass up and tag him, bitch. Get your ass up. Why the fuck they taking so long to tag out? Shit. Dramatic effect. Boy, they some straight actors.
Round and take the clothesline. A common spot in tag team matches is where the legal wrestler is crawling on the mat and is trying to reach their partner
up,
to tag out. However, the legal wrestler usually can't see where their opponents are and won't know when precisely to tag out. To help them out, the wrestler on the ring apron will make a signal with their hand. If their palm is facing down, it tells the legal wrestler not to tag in. But when the palm faces up, that's the signal to make the tag. Now, you won't see every WWE wrestler do this. The reason might be that not all wrestlers are trained the same way. Another reason is that some spots don't require precise timing, so there's no reason to make any signals. WWE referees also have their own secret hand signals. After a wrestler takes a big spot, like going through a table, the referee will check on them. While it looks like the ref is just talking to the wrestler, they're actually putting their hand in the wrestler's hand. If the wrestler squeezes the referee's hand, that means the wrestler is okay. After getting the squeeze, the referee will raise a closed fist into the air. This tells the backstage personnel that everything is okay. If the wrestler doesn't squeeze the referee's hand, the ref will make an X sign with both of their arms. If the injury is pretty obvious, the referee will just make the X sign without checking in with the wrestler. At the first Hell in a Cell pay-per-view, Randy Orton and John Cena faced off
for
the
WWE
Championship.
Not good.
The two had a solid match, but about midway into the contest, a WWE secret was accidentally exposed. Randy Orton hit John Cena with his vintage inverted headlock backbreaker, which caused a blade to fall onto the mat.
B1000. Do y'all motherfuckers wear jean shorts? I got something to ask you. How do y'all put them bitches on? I hate jean shorts. How the fuck did John Cena make jean shorts cool? I don't know when I started hating jean shorts, but I just like jean shorts, nigga. Like, come on now. That nigga John Cena, that was his attire.
That means the wrestler's okay. After getting the
dark blue light blue raise a close hand
into the air, this tells the backstage personnel that everything is okay. If the wrestler doesn't squeeze the okay. referee's hand, the ref will make an X sign with
we went back too far
to bleed during the match. The referee quickly picked up the blade, and the performance continued. Neither wrestler ended up bleeding during the match, but it's unknown if it was because Cena lost his blade.
Hey.
Hell in a Cell just has a habit of exposing secrets, even since the beginning. At the 1987 Bad Blood pay-per-view, Shawn Michaels and The Undertaker went face-to-face in the first ever Hell in a Cell match. Before the two stars made their entrances, Sergeant Slaughter, who was the on-screen commissioner, checked under the ring to make sure nobody was hiding underneath it. The camera went in for a close shot and accidentally revealed an amplifier. If you don't know,
the fuck that is
sound equipment under the ring so that when a wrestler hits the mat, it sounds even more impressive.
Oh! And his feet just hit the rope of the cage.
What a guy.
Luckily for WWE, by the end of the match, everybody had forgotten about what they saw underneath the ring.
Together
like peanut butter and jelly, but the faceless one is completely innocent when it comes to this mistake. When Sakara debuted in April 2011, he jumped into the ring and fought off Sheamus. Unfortunately, right before the luchador dove in, the cameraman accidentally revealed a bit too much and showed the trampoline Sin Cara jumped off of to make his entrance.
What?
The WWE camera crew got better at hiding this as Sin Cara continued to wrestle, but the masked wrestler's career
that was hard, exactly though.
Started off on the right angle. At WrestleMania 7, Jake the Snake Roberts took on the model Rick Martel in a blindfold match. Unfortunately, the illusion that both men were completely blind. Fell apart before the bell had even run. While the referees were getting the blindfolds on each competitor, Jake pulled part of the cloth away, revealing two spots they could see from. It didn't help that the camera was pointed directly at him either. Everything else went smoothly, but that botch at the beginning didn't help anyone suspend their disbelief. This next one's a little different, but I think you'll enjoy it. Back in March of 2020, WWE held its first show in the Performance Center with no fans in attendance. Ooh. Despite the lack of crowd noise, everything was going fine.
Was that because of Corona?
A commercial break. Bayley and Sasha Banks were wrestling Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross, and once it was time for an ad break, everyone decided to stop wrestling. After all, nobody was watching. Except that people were. On some of the international feeds, SmackDown returned a bit too early, and all four wrestlers were out of character and not wrestling. In the clip, the four women can be seen talking to each other, the ropes and the turnbuckles.
Race has bright.
For about a minute, and then they begin getting ready to start the match again. Being that this happened in 2020, it wasn't a huge deal, but imagine if something like this happened back in the 70s or 80s. That would have been a pretty big secret that got exposed. The Hell in a Cell match between Seth Rollins
and Edge was on a lunch break.
The rivalry had become incredibly heated, and the two went all out in their final match. Tons of weapons were used, including a wrench that Seth used to try and attack Edge's eye. After teaming with Bad Bunny at WrestleMania, Damian Priest went back to being solo and took on The Miz and John Morrison in a handicap match. At one point, Priest performed an awesome flip over the top rope and out
that
of the
was
way.
Hard.
Unfortunately, Priest's leg accidentally hit John Morrison in the head. Right after the move, cameras caught John Morrison quietly telling Damian Priest everything was good, as well as Morrison giving his opponent a love pat before getting back into character and selling the move. In addition to playing their role in the match, WWE referees also handle most of the communication. If there's something the WWE producers and directors want the wrestlers to know, they'll tell the referee by talking to him or her through the referee's earpiece. An example of this was shown live on Raw. Elias and Jackson Riker were facing off in a Symphony of Destruction.
That's crazy.
While fighting, Elias accidentally got busted open. WWE has a no-blood policy and likes to avoid it when they can, especially during their PG shows. After Elias began to bleed, someone backstage told the referee to tell Elias to wipe off the blood, which Elias did immediately. This apparently wasn't communicated to the production crew, and the whole thing was shown on camera. WWE likes to make their wrestlers seem larger than life.
Boy, Brock Lesnar, big ass dude, bro.
And one of them was exposed live on Raw.
Was that Bang Way on 101?
Being interviewed backstage when Austin Theory interrupted. The camera pulled back a bit too far and revealed that the interviewer was bending his knees in order to make the wrestlers seem taller. This is one of the reasons why WWE likes to hire women for backstage interview roles, since they usually don't have to adjust their height to make the wrestlers appear taller.
How
Why does it even matter? The nigga's short, he's short.
Be like John. He's a digital marketer at a large furniture.
I don't get that.
His company advertises with.
Let me cancel this before I start about that. Well, that was 20 secrets of the WWE. And I'm not even gonna lie. I am brain bobbled. What is discombobulated brain fucked, bro? I learned a lot. And that tells me that WWE, man, is a big ass Warner Brothers studio shit. Them niggas real actors, bro. I salute them. They got a script, communication, they own stunt dubbies. Man, them boys, they man out here making movies. So, hey, like, comment, subscribe, tune in, more views on the way. Hit the A button and help the algorithm out. Comment down below any videos you want me to react to. Or just say what's up or hey, what's anything. Just talk to a nigga. Subscribe, man. If you subscribe, the family get bigger. If it get bigger, it get litter, right? Duh. So let's turn this mug up, man. Hey, I appreciate everybody just tuning in, showing love. I'll see y'all in the next video.